Welcome learners in the series of videos on topology. We are studying the connected spaces. In the previous video, we have seen the definition of separation and some observations from the definition and some connected spaces examples. Now, as stated in the previous video, we will prove that any interval in R with usual topology is connected. So let us put that as theorem, any interval in R with usual topology, so we denote it by RU, is connected. To show that something is connected is a little bit of trickier job, because we have to show that there does not exist any separation. Okay, but to show that something is disconnected, you can, if you give a simple separation, then you are done. But in this case, you have to show that there does not exist any separation. And the general proof or general way to show that something is connected is by contradiction. So you assume that it is not connected and get some contradiction. Okay, so we will follow the same procedure. So we will assume that I, let us take the interval I first. So let I be an interval, right? And suppose that I is not connected. Suppose I is not connected, right? If it is not connected, that means there is a separation. So let A comma B be separation of I or for I. Okay. Now remember, when you take I will be the separation will be in the subspace topology. We have seen the last example. Alright. So in this, A and B is a separation of I, means A and B are open in I as a subspace topology. This implies, let us say A and B are open in I as subspace topology. So since these are open in I in a subspace topology, by the definition of open sets, there exist some open sets U, V, whatever in RU, such that A can be written as I intersection that open set. So for A, there will be some open set, and for B, there will be some another open set. Okay, so let us take G and H for that. So then there exist G, let us take G and H. So G and H open sets in the whole space, say RU, such that A can be written as some open set, so I intersection G, and this B can be written as I intersection H. This is by definition of open set in a subspace. Okay, now so now let us take two points A and B in A and B respectively. So let us take A, that A belongs to A, and let us take B belongs to B. Let us take two points. Now since A is the intersection of G and I, this implies this A will be a subset of G and this B will be the subset of H. This implies this A belongs to G also and B belongs to H also. So by the law of trichotomy now, this A and B are from the real numbers and R follows the law of trichotomy. This implies either A will be equals to B, or A is less than B, or A greater than B. Of course, A is not equals to B because this A and B is a separation for I. So if A equals to B, then A intersection B will not be empty. That will be a contradiction for this assumption, right? So let us assume that A is less than B. Assume that A is less than B. That means you have this real line, you have A this side and you have B this side. Okay, now let us take a set, let D is equal to set of all x belonging to the set G. Remember, what is G? G, we have got it from here, right? G is an open set in RU such that A can be written as I intersection G. So let us take D to the set of all x belonging to G such that we know what is A and B. So you take all those elements which are less than or equals to B. Okay, so since this A is in A, obviously that A will be in I, B will be in I, right? And I is the interval. So this will be a subset of I, because A and B belongs to I. That means all those points between A and B also in I, because I is the interval. Now, since we say that D is non-empty, why? You pause the video, you can check it out. Give a point in D. Now we say that this D is non-empty because here we have a point A in G. We are taking all those points in G such that this happens. Now this, we know A belongs to G and A is equals to A here. So since A belongs to D, we have D which is non-empty because we have a point in D, and also D is bounded above. Why? Because since every point in D, x is less than or equals to B for all x belonging to D, because this is bounded above, implies D is bounded above by B. So by a property we say that the D admits a supremum. So in the comment box, name the property which says that if we have a non-empty subset of R which is bounded above, then it has a supremum. Put that in the comment box. Alright, so since x is less than equals to b, we have D is bounded above and D is non-empty. This implies D admits or has D admits a supremum. Also, you can show that supremum is unique. Supremum in R. So that supremum may or may not be in D. That is the different issue, right? Say, let us take that supremum to be alpha is equals to supremum of D. Okay, that means all those elements of D are less than or equals to alpha. So first, it is a upper bound of D and it is a least upper bound of D. That is the supremum. Since this alpha is least upper bound LUB of D, and also we know that A belongs to D, all the elements of D are less than or equals to alpha and A belongs to D, this implies A will be less than or equals to alpha. First point. Another, we have to show that alpha is less than or equals to B. So for that, since we know that B is upper bound of D, and we have denoted alpha is least upper bound of D, we get alpha is less than or equals to the upper bound, because this is the least upper bound and B is any other upper bound. So alpha will be less than or equals to B. That is what we have proved, is A is less than or equals to alpha and alpha is less than or equals to B. Therefore, that is what we have proved, is A is less than or equals to alpha and alpha is less than or equals to B. This implies we have this alpha in I, right? I is the interval. Okay, and A and B belongs to I, that means all those points inside also belongs to I. And we know that I is nothing but A union B, because A and B is a separation for I. So alpha belongs to A union B implies this alpha belongs to A, or this alpha belongs to B. So we will show that this alpha is neither in A, it is nor in B. That means alpha is not in A union B, that is a contradiction. And that contradiction, we will say that the assumption, whatever we have assumed, that is I separated, is false, and hence I is connected. Okay, so from here also we can say that this implies A is a subset of G. So alpha also belongs to G, or this alpha is in H. Okay, so we will use this to show this. Now, case 1, let us assume that alpha belongs to G. Let us assume that alpha belongs to G. What is G? G is open set in R with usual topology. So since G is open in R with usual topology and alpha belongs to G, that means there exists a neighborhood of alpha which is contained inside G. So therefore this implies there exists a positive radius, say R greater than 0, such that the open interval alpha minus R and alpha plus R is contained inside G. Okay, because G is open. So if G is open, by the definition of open sets, alpha is in G, there exists a neighborhood which will contain inside G. And this is the neighborhoods, right? Open intervals are the neighborhoods. So if notice here, therefore, if we have alpha plus R by 2, alpha plus R by 2 will be less than alpha plus R, and it will be greater than alpha minus R. So alpha plus R by 2 will be in G. Okay, first point. Second point, this A will be less than or equals to alpha plus R by 2. Right? This A is less than or equals to alpha. Of course, if you add some R by 2, that will be A will be less than or equals to A will be less than or equals to alpha plus R by 2. And now we will show that this alpha plus R by 2 will be less than B. Why? Now, if alpha plus R by 2 is greater than B, what happens? If alpha plus R by 2 is greater than B, this will imply that this B will belong to, obviously that is in I, that will be in G, and I intersection G is equals to A, giving contradiction to the fact. See, which contradiction? Why you are getting contradiction if B belongs to A? Right? Therefore, B does not belong to A, and therefore this B is less greater than or equals to alpha plus R by 2. So if you notice here, we have showed that alpha plus R by 2 is in G, and it lies between A and B. This implies alpha plus R by 2 belongs to D, right? Because alpha plus R by 2, first of all, we proved it is in G. Secondly, we proved it that it lies between A and B, and we have taken set D to be the set of all those x in G such that those lies between A and B. So of course, this alpha plus R by 2 will be in D, and this is contradiction. This is contradiction. So again, you should work out why we are getting the contradiction. Right? If you know, you can put that in the comment box. If you don't know, again, you can put that in the comment box. I will be happy to help over there. Right? So this is a contradiction. Therefore, alpha does not belong to G, and if alpha does not belong to G, this implies this alpha does not belong to E. So as I said, we will prove that this alpha is neither in A nor in B. That means alpha cannot be in union, that is a contradiction, because here we proved that alpha is in I. Okay, so this alpha is not in A. Let's go for case 2 and see what happens to case 2. For case 2, we have that alpha belongs to H. You can take a break, you can see what happens if alpha belongs to H. How we will justify that alpha is not in B. Okay, now since also H is open in R, since this H is open in R with usual topology and this alpha is in H, this implies there exists some radius, say R1. We already used R, so let us use R1 now. R1 greater than 0 such that this alpha minus R1 comma alpha plus R2 is in H. Okay, and remember this alpha is a supremum. Okay, since alpha is supremum, alpha is a supremum implies alpha minus R1 is not the upper bound, Let us see how it is. Like we have this. Okay, we have alpha. We have alpha minus R1. Alpha plus R1. So we have this alpha. We have this alpha minus one. Alpha minus R1. We know that alpha is not the alpha is the supremum. That means this is not the supremum. That means there exists a point in this set, in this in between alpha minus R1 and alpha. So since alpha is supremum and alpha minus R1 is not the supremum or not the upper bound, this implies there exists some element U belonging to the D such that this in between this. So alpha minus R1 is less than U. Okay, so you have U somewhere here. Okay, so clearly also we know that this U, okay, let me write, clearly this U is less than or equals to alpha. It may be strictly less than. Okay, this implies U will belong to alpha minus R1 and alpha plus R1, because alpha U is less than, that is strictly U is less than alpha and this is greater than alpha. That means U will be inside this, because U already is greater than alpha minus R1, and we know that this is contained inside H. So this is contained inside H, and by definition U belongs to G. This is by by definition. So and also this U is in I, because this U is in between A and B, so that will be in I. I is the interval. This implies this U belongs to I. Also, it belongs to H, so I intersection H is nothing but A, and also this U belongs to I, and we prove that by definition it belongs to G, and I intersection G is equals to B. This implies this U belongs to A intersection B. This is contradiction. Why? Justify why it is contradiction. Okay, and we got this contradiction. This implies alpha will not be in H, and if it is not in H, this implies this alpha is not in B. Therefore, hence, alpha does not belong to A union B, which is equals to I. And this is contradiction, giving contradiction. Again, Y. So what we proved is, we got the contradiction, hence we say that this I is connected because we have assumed that A and B is a separation phi. We got a contradiction in both the cases. So this contradiction suggests us that I is a connected set, giving contradiction, and hence I is connected. Okay. Now, as a simple remark, you can easily prove this by using some simple concept. Let us take a function, let f from x to y, which is a homeomorphism. Then if you have a separation for x, so then suppose you have separation, say u comma v is separation for x, then fu comma fv will be the separation of y, and again ulta is also there. So for x, if and only if fu fv is separation for y. In particular, if x is connected, then y is connected, and if y is connected, then x is connected by using this. So prove this. So in particular, let us put that statement in particular. X is connected if and only if y is connected. Prove this. So if you have a homeomorphism, two spaces are homeomorphic, then both are connected or both are disconnected together. Right? It is not possible that x will be connected and y is disconnected by if we have this homeomorphism. Okay. So this is all about our this today's video. We have proved that any interval in R is connected, of course R with usual topology. In the next video, we will see or we will prove that a continuous image of a connected space is connected.